In the foreground, a young man stands upon a rocky precipice with his back to the viewer. His hair caught in a wind, the wanderer gazes out on a landscape covered in a thick sea of fog. Beyond, the pervading fog stretches out indefinitely, eventually merging with the horizon and becoming indistinguishable from the cloud-filled sky. Romantic painter Caspar David Friedrich's Wanderer Above a Sea of Fog is one of his most famous landscapes. The ambiguity of the painting leaves the onlookers wondering whether the man is triumphant, having hiked to the top of the mountain and mastered the landscape, or whether the murky fog signifies an uncertain future. The people in Friedrich's landscapes are frequently on the verge of things, the edge of a sea, the edge of a valley, predicament that gives rise to the suggestions of journeys being made, not of journeys being completed. In this film, there is one quote that points to our fear of growing up.
Well, the nice thing about being old is you've got nothing much to lose.
To be old is to arrive, to have already waded out of the fog, and to survey your life from the safety of the mountaintop. Like the young man, Sophie too stands at the edge of a precipice. She surveys the view before her, a wanderer who has finally made it out of the fog. She has finally arrived at the top. However, Sophie does not display the triumphant stance of the young man. Instead, she's an old woman, and as she wanders to the edge, we begin to question, what now? With the frequent shots of the castle climbing, we as the audience expect the arrival to mean something. But in what is perhaps one of the most quietly terrifying shots of the film, we realize that there is no arrival, that we must trudge back to war again and fall back down into the abyss. Periods of transition are terrifying. A move, a new job, the loss of a relationship. But perhaps the most universal and one of the most terrifying periods of transition is that of growing up. It is in these moments that you no longer know how to define the self, and in which you are forced to grapple for a new identity. When we first meet Sophie, she knows her role. She is the eldest, and her place is at the hatter shop, at the periphery of society. When the Witch of the Waste curses Sophie, her reaction to her old age is much more muted than we expect.
This isn't so bad now, is it? You're still in pretty good shape, and your clothes finally suit you.
In fact, old age isn't the terrifying curse that we as the audience anticipate. Sophie retains her station on the periphery of society, slowly but surely making her way to the waste with the distinctive and easily defined mannerisms of an old crone. She no longer needs to grapple for a new identity. She's been given one. In moments of great vulnerability, Sophie's curse is what she retreats into to protect herself. For Sophie, to arrive is to be old, is to be safe. To grow up is to be vulnerable without the shield of who you once were.
I've never felt so peaceful before.
Howl's Moving Castle is a film about the grief of growing up and becoming an adult. We can see this clearly epitomized in the character Howl, a wizard with a child's heart.
It's still just the heart of a child.
When we first meet Howl, his obsession with his appearance strikes us as superficial and vain. Yet later on, we find out that his appearance copies that of Madame Solomon's apprentices, young boys who appear to be frozen in the age of adolescence. Hal himself acts like a stereotypical teenager.
Sophie! You sabotaged me! Look! Look what you've done to my hair!
And at one point, casting Sophie in the role of his mother.
Just say that you're Pendragon's mother.
Even Markle takes on the disguise of the archetypal wise old man, acting as Hal's surrogate paternal figure and saving him, albeit temporarily, from the authorities. At first glance, Hal's vanity and childish behavior is funny, and at times annoying. And yet, is Hal's fear of growing up totally unfounded? Like the romantics of the 19th century, does Miyazaki not idealize the child in favor of the adult? Films like Spirited Away and My Neighbor Totoro venerate the special relationship a child has with nature and magic. Miyazaki's understanding of childhood is one of a trans-historical collective state, in which a child is a repository of special faculties that allows them to tap into a form of creative power that is lost in the transition to adulthood.
I'm losing my witch's powers.
We can see this when we venture into Hal's past. Our first introduction to shooting stars are usually in the forms of fairy tales. The motif of wishing upon a shooting star is prevalent in children's stories, and it's almost perceived as having the same rarity as seeing a unicorn. And the popular notion of blink and you'll miss it stresses its evanescent nature. Miyazaki's use of shooting stars epitomizes the ephemeral creative power that a child has. The beauty of this phenomenon is tragically brief. As the shooting stars race to the ground, we watch their inevitable death. But as we see with Hal, clinging onto a shooting star transforms it into a demon. Unlike a star, Calcifer is a fire bound to a hearth. Throughout the film, we constantly revisit the idea of the destruction of fire. To hold onto something so tightly, so as not to let it go, destroys the very thing we are hoping to keep. If childhood is embodied by the ephemeral and yet completely liberated journey of the shooting star, then to bind it is to take away the freedom which gives this very thing value. To bind is to expose yourself to the danger and destructions of its fires.
If you drown me, then Howell will die too.
At the end of the movie, Hal's survival is dependent on taking Becca's heart, even at the risk of losing Calcifer. And yet we find that when Hal does take it back, Calcifer remains, returned to his former glory as a star, no longer earthbound but playful and free. Hal stands on his own precipice, clinging desperately to his childhood whilst being dragged into adulthood. In this film and many others, adults are associated with war, curses, and destruction. It is no wonder Hal often runs away, escaping the responsibilities that bind him as a grown-up. And yet, Hal does not succeed in being a child. Instead, he's stuck in the liminal space between childhood and adulthood. Hal's castle is powered by Calcifer and his own heart, and so in a way we can see his castle as a reflection of Hal's inner self. The zoomorphic form of his castle resembles an amphibian creature, stuck between land and sea. Its gait seems almost painful, its structure often looking on the brink of collapse. This form is not one which can last. If the state of the castle symbolizes the growth of Hal, then Miyazaki does nothing to assure us that the transition to adulthood is painless. Instead, we watch the terrifying metamorphosis and breakdown of the castle. Till it too teeters on the knife edge of a mountain, and finally falls into the abyss. Miyazaki also borrows elements from Alice in Wonderland, a story that deals with the tragic and inevitable loss of childhood innocence. Sophie falls, and we can see Hal confined in a tangle of tunnels, struggling to find his own way out of the rabbit hole. This spatial motif occurs throughout the film. The Witch of the Waste squeezes herself into her small carriage. The interior of the castle changes several times. A vast ocean and sky appear to reside within a greenhouse. Nothing is as it seems, and the uncomfortable vastness, the metamorphosis and manipulation of space mimics the discomfort of being too big or too small for your own skin. Hal's moving castle outlines our fear of transitions. When we are falling between who we once were and who we are to become. Growing up is painful, and yet necessary. At first glance, Miyazaki appears to be asking, what do we lose if we grow up? What exactly are we grieving for? In response, we are told, what do we lose if we refuse?